it's great to have that mentality from the demo scene. Anyway, all right, so this was my little talk. This is just the warm-up, the opening act for the real show, because now I'd like to invite my panelists to join me on stage. So first, you know him from this morning, Richard LeMarchand from USC Games, University of Southern California. Welcome. Welcome. Talk show style, shaking hands, please. You can pick your seat, Richard.
I'm going to sit right here, Per.
Brilliant.
Next to talk show
And
style.
Next, Gemma Thompson. Gemma is an independent game designer, and she's also the former chair of our diversity initiative, DivisG, and a founding board member of that organization. Patrick Hansson, Korn Krau, and at least six other organizations. Always the sayer of truth, never shying away from the controversial. Patrick Hansson, great to have you. Welcome. And last but not least, Stefan Ljungqvist. Stefan is now with a company called Goodbye Kansas, but he learned his moves with the Drakar & Demoner in the 1980s and 1990s, and he spent 10 years at Avalanche making those games. All right. So I have the best possible panel, and the theme for this panel is 15 years, looking back 15 years and looking 15 years ahead. So we'll start with looking back 15 years, or what has happened in the 15 years that have passed. Richard, I'd like to start with you. And we talked a little bit about this in the Q&A in your talk this morning, how characters are different and how we relate to characters. How do you see game characters? How have they evolved in the last decade and a half?
Well, Per, I was in the time since we've been chatting, I've been thinking about the way that the games that I worked on over the course of the last 15 years charted, no pun intended, a kind of course in their development. In 2001, on Halloween, October 31st in 2001, the team that I was on shipped a game called Soul Reaver 2 in the Legacy of Kain series, and it was the second game that I'd made with Amy Hennig, who's the creative director and game director of the Uncharted series for the first three games. And I was very lucky to have got to start working with Amy on that series. I had mainly worked to that point on platform games that had some story elements, but that were mainly, I think, oriented towards a younger audience, so the story theme were simpler, the characters were kind of a bit simpler, a bit more two-dimensional. But with the Soul Reaver series, we were really reaching to try and do something that had some more kind of literary weight, you know, that was about the real stuff of being a human. And even though it was a genre fantasy story, it was kind of a gothic horror fantasy about a vampire, one of a number of vampire lords who'd kind of fallen and become a demonic creature. Some of Amy's key influences were indeed highly literary, things like Milton's poem Paradise Lost, which is about the fall of Lucifer from heaven, and also T.S. Eliot's poem The Wasteland, kind of it has apocalyptic themes in it. And these were themes that we were drawing out in the story. And and I've often said over the years that I think the experience of making these, the Soul Reaver games, was in a way perhaps a kind of rehearsal. We were getting ready to make a game like Uncharted, where, again, in the, you know, the difference between a game like Gex, about a cartoon gecko parodying Hollywood, to Soul Reaver, which was a kind of evolution for me in terms of how personal that game was, in terms of what I wanted to express. So there was another leap towards the Uncharted games, which are, you know, sort of action-adventure. I like to think of them as romantic comedies, in a way, the Uncharted games. And I think that is quite a significant number of steps towards characters that we can recognize as the people that we know from our lives. Amy has talked a lot about the difference between plot-driven storytelling and character-driven storytelling. I think many video game stories are naturally plot-driven because of the sort of systemic nature of video games. So they're about sort of, you know, maybe nation-states going to war or epic fantasy families colliding. But really, the stuff that gets us interested in stories is the characters. It's the nature of the individuals, the way that they relate to each other, the things that they're trying to get from each other, and all of the adventure in a story results from that conflict and struggle between individual characters. So I think that's what we're going to see. We have been seeing a lot more of. It's part of what's brought us all of the great storytelling games that we now have, and we can expect to see more of that in the future.
So this sort of brings us into the old interactive versus narrative question. Can we have characters without stories?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think that when we get into this domain, the boundaries between story and narrative, which are arguably slightly different things, the boundaries between stories that we, the designers, plan and tell, which are fixed, and as opposed to the stories that emerge from the actions of the players in the game, these boundaries are actually, these aren't binary opposites. They're kind of porous. And, you know, the current wave of open world storytelling games are experimenting with this, I think. There are stories embedded in a contemporary character action game created by the designers, but there are also narratives that will be created by the players. And I think we'll see increasingly sophisticated game mechanics that support all these different kinds of narrative.
Anyone else on characters and stories? I'm thinking about, it's easy to sort of restrict yourself to talk about AAA and PC. What's the storyline in the Candy Crush game, for example? There's characters definitely, but how do you apply the thinking from what Richard just said to mobile games? Stefan, yes.
I can only speak from my perspective of working on open world games, which might be a little bit different. I think the approach that we had was to reinforce player autonomy. Like, we made a series called Just Cause, and I think from the get-go we were thinking about giving the player the role of this character, Rico, which is the avatar in the game. But we quickly realized that what we actually wanted to do was to have you, like, we provide you with the player autonomy instead of creating a story. I mean, obviously we have some story in the game. It kind of sucks, but it's there. I think we usually say that we have a number, you correct me if I'm wrong afterwards, but I think it's about 18% of the people playing Just Cause, I don't want to mention the number, it's not three, actually play the storyline to the end. So that's quite a significant low number, if you ask me. However, we have a lot of players that spent maybe 500-600 hours in the game. So, are they playing the game for the story? Are they playing the game for the characters? I don't know. Do they play because they think it's awesome and fun, and they think they have some control of the character? Yes. Is there a progression with playing Rico? Over the course of three games, yes, because at the end, in the third game, we really try to bring story into the game. So if you play that and you play two, you will hopefully realize that there is a significant change in providing some kind of background or story to Rico. But like compared to Uncharted, I think there's a huge difference in the type of game that Just Cause ended up being compared to Uncharted.
Could I make a comment?
Yes, of course.
So actually, I'd like to hold up the Just Cause series as a very interesting series around this issue. I played some Just Cause 3 over the break. I don't know if you worked on that game. And I think it's terrific from a storytelling and narrative point of view. The fact that there is a plot line running through it, it's a great example of what I was just describing. But there are all of these arguably narrative moments when I pull down some gigantic exploding towers. These are the stories that, from the beginning of the Just Cause series, I've heard my friends and colleagues telling each other in the break room, you know, about what they played in Just Cause last night. This, oh, you wouldn't believe this thing that happened. I pulled it and attached it to that and it blew off. And I think actually these are part of the narrative experience of games, the player stories. And I also think Just Cause 3 is a wonderful example of great character in games. I think Rico is a very interesting character. We don't see many Latino men as the heroes of video games. I forget her name, I'm afraid, but the woman scientist. We don't see many older women in games. We don't see many Arab people in games in protagonist roles. And her mixture of great intelligence and her kind of warmth and friendship towards Rico, but she's kind of grumpy, makes this amazing character diamond that made her a fascinating character to me. So compliments to you guys. It's awesome.
Stefan, can you, if you hold that thought and we'll...
It was really quick.
Okay, yeah, thing. Okay.
It was really quick. I forgot one thing. So... true to that point, when we were making even the first game, we were talking about the player creates his own story inside of the sandbox. So you're spot on. That's where I go. That's the goal.
Brilliant. Thank you. And Gemma, can I come to you now? Because I think what I take away from what Richard and Stefan just said is that it's actually the player that owns the game, and they create their own game inside the game, let's say. How have players changed in the past 15 years?
Yeah, it's interesting, the 15-year marker, because that's, I'm going to show my relative lack of age, I suppose, at this point. 15 years ago was the launch of the GameCube, and that was basically, I consider that my formative console. There are a number of games on there where action platformers were my genre. I grew up really loving the Sonic the Hedgehog series on Mega Drive. And so the shift from that gradually through Dreamcast to really solid character-driven experiences on GameCube. But then everything from there seemed to gravitate towards, it's almost like the past 15 years have been the age of the avatar. And I think it's more of a technological point, and I'm not going to sidetrack to that too much. But I think very much the players began expecting more of their own input into the games. And I think this is now expressed in the current feeling we have that we want to see more representation in games, is because players have been able to project themselves into these worlds more and more as technology has kept up. I think that's basically my point, actually.
But what about...
Yeah, customizable characters and such like, yeah. Like I'd say, that furthering the link between the player and the way they're seeing themselves in the world, and then, by extension, their actions upon the world.
But what about the point I was making, moving away from being nerds, making games for other nerds, instead making games for everybody? There's all kinds of new players that don't share these cultural references that you do as a game designer. Has that changed the way we make games?
I would say so, but actually, in some respect, I think that the fact that people making games these days have grown up with video games is also a factor. I think it's interesting that we are diversifying games so much, but I think a contributing factor is this, that the way we've grown up with games that we've already played, and so we're deviating from that, perhaps because we don't necessarily want to play what we grew up with. And I think because games existed in a bit of that isolated bubble beforehand, maybe the fact that we're looking at those games and thinking we want something different is then what is bringing new people in. It's this really weird kind of contrast. I'm not sure. Does anyone else have any thoughts on that?
That's like the thought of the day. That's something we need to ponder before we can say anything useful about that. Anyone else on the players? Stefan? Yeah, of course.
Yeah, I think the way that we play games has changed a little bit. Like I think that's part of your question, is how did we play games 15 years ago? And the transition, it's all about transition of platform, transition of gameplay mechanics. I mean, AAA, 15 years ago, you would argue that kind of started, it took off in a really powerful way. You look at the 10 years ahead, it changed. So everything went mobile, and people were, to Patrick's talk yesterday, like the market is really changing. We have to use the word market because we're making entertainment products. So we have to realize that's a fact. So everybody's trying to chase the big market, or not everyone, thankfully. And that's also now a current question with VR, for example. Are everybody going to interact with the VR platform? Is that the new thing? So I think transition is an important question. And one thing that I personally, I'm really interested in isolation. So I think that's grown even worse, that people are going to play games, that they become more and more isolated behind screens. If you go on the subway, people are looking in their phones. And then you can argue that we have a lot of multiplayer games. But that's also where you are behind your screen, you feel like another person, and maybe you take the right to be very offensive. You almost become another person. I think the esport culture, to some extent, have made people more aggressive towards each other because you don't have that human connection. I would argue that people wouldn't write or express half of those opinions if they actually met the other one face to face. So we will talk a little bit about the future later. I just want to conclude with I'm kind of concerned of current generations growing up with this isolation and lacking of human contact, which I think trust is a good example. I really love that mechanic, the hugging mechanic. It's the first time I've, in a long, long time, I've seen someone come up with that type of mechanic that rewards human contact.
No.
Wow, I can't really follow that up with anything quite so popular. But yeah, I was just going to say that it's interesting then that because we have empowered the player to have exact so much control and presence within these games, that yes, I agree that games have actually become generally a more singular experience now. I think this is also expressed in the fact that it's really hard to find a local co-op game these days. I've had this problem with my husband sat at home, who's not much of a gamer, but I sort of bring him in to try and play these experiences. And we find ourselves having to go back to the GameCube, because that was a time when it was more understood that you... I think games companies maybe were pushing the gather around and have a party around this game kind of thing. So GameCube in particular was a console rich in multiplayer experiences, but that's not so much the case these days. And there are a few theories as to why, and
Can I quickly say, I think actually we're about to see a renaissance in local multiplayer games. There's lots of interest among our students in making them, and a recent game, Chambara, that won the Dare to Be Digital competition, is going to be the first game that we ship on the USC Games publishing label later this summer, and it's a great local multiplayer game. I read an interesting thing this week that it was a new scientific or sociological study that said that what teenagers, 13-year-olds, most value right now is face-to-face time and online privacy, shared online spaces but that are private and away from the people that they don't want to interact with, namely adults. And I think that is going to play out in the marketplace for things like local multiplayer games.
But what do you make of YouTubers? Because there's a social dimension to that. We have kids today don't play games, they watch other kids playing games. So actually you're screwed because nobody will buy your games growing up. Patrick.
I waited till last so I can finish off the previous discussion. I'm going to do the YouTubers too, but nothing has changed. Thank you very much. Nothing has changed. We have changed. That's the key to everything. We see new markets opening up, and what comes? The same type of Candy Crush I played when I started come with the new players. Nothing has changed. And an example of that is something I don't want to see again. Can you please bury it forever? Point and click games. No, please, I don't want them to come back again. So nothing has changed. The people has changed. These different types of people, these new generations coming in, and they all have to do, I say, like, games are like red wine. That's a quote I use. And some say, could it be like champagne? Yeah, it can be like champagne too. Games are like red wine. When you're young and you want to get high, I was about to say drunk, then you take any kind of red wine. The cheap, easy one. And the more you start drinking red wine continuously, the more refined your palate will become. So that means that the wines that you didn't like before, it was dry and tasting like ättika, what you call that in English?
Vinegar.
Vinegar, yeah. These are now the ones you prefer, and the old bagging box is no longer an option for you. So you change, and what we have been seeing, all people sitting up here and sitting down there, is a change in markets. We see a lot of new people. And remember what I said yesterday? Game industry, we are idiots. So we don't see and understand that. So all the publisher wants the new market money that they see. But it's new people coming in, and the one that likes it's like red wine. Gonna get a refined palette, evolve, play the games that we are playing right now. I don't know you, I started a long time ago, your GameCube. I missed that part totally myself. So I was playing like turn-based strategy games at that time myself, a couple of years before that too. So, and YouTubers?
Well, actually, let's save the YouTubers, because this begs a question, Patrick. Because 15 years ago, when I used to be a publisher, you used to pitch games to me. And I would argue that you haven't changed a bit in 15 years. So how has Patrick Hansson changed in 15 years?
My quote. This is the first publisher I was to. I like to keep it in the family, who is Swedish. Pondvision. I published digital distribution and free to play to this man. The quotes you saw yesterday.
What did I say?
Nothing. Right. You said very good things. Like
Great. I'm sure I did. I was probably clueless because I had a sales force to keep feeding the machine.
I don't change. I'm the only one. Yeah.
Well. That's not too late, Patrick. that brings us then to does this qualify as the business? How the business has changed in 15 years? I think we can do more on the business. Yeah, Stefan, how has the business changed in 15 years?
Wow, the business of actually consuming games, or the business for us as game developers of trying to get our game out?
You decide.
Okay, so I'll start with the last one. So when we started Avalanche, there was a number of big companies that would accept like a pitch with the magnitude of a huge game like Just Cause or any other open world game. So let's say that there roughly was about 25 companies that would publish such a game. So we visited them all with number two. Obviously, we were fortunate enough to start off with Eidos, an old company, maybe. Nobody knows about them anymore, but they were the original company that published Hitman, the Hitman series, for example. So I think looking at the industry today, I use the word industry now, because if you go from Avalanche, a big studio, and you have publishers, you have to be part of the industry, right? Maybe today there are four companies that would, or five maybe, that would be able to publish a game of that magnitude. So obviously that has affected the number of studios, especially independent ones, that have the possibility of making a game of the ambition or caliber of what we see in Just Cause 3, for example, or Mad Max, I would argue. So I think there's a huge change there. But also I think there's a positive thing about that. It has forced, not forced, but some developers that have been doing this for a long, long time have found another way forward in creating games. And that's where we see a lot of, can I say fake indies? Because they're not, or indies with other, maybe chances of becoming successful. They've been doing a lot of AAA games. Maybe they have a name for themselves. Even to Patrick's point yesterday, game developers don't have names in the industry like rock stars, right? We are hidden because it's a team effort. So usually we are part of a huge team. But what happens is that we've gone back, created these small teams because we are getting tired of being in a 200-man team, working with a lot of red tape, and that has also then opened up for a lot of new type of games that adds a little bit more creativity. We're not working with games that takes 3 years to make because we're getting old and we don't have 3 to 5 years to spend on each game. And really, we're just making a game. Does that have to take 3 years? I don't know. This has become really interesting also because it brings back what I call real games, games that has score. When I grew up, every game had, you know, we were competing with score. And I'm very fond of that. So we used to, you know, compete in even pinball. It's like original type of game. So I think that the business side from that perspective has changed dramatically. And then a couple of years ago, people said, yeah, you just bring your game to Steam and you can self-publish. I think that also has changed in the last 2 years. I mean, because Steam is flooded with games. So if you ever hear, just bring your game to Steam, release it, you're going to make shitloads of money and you have your creative freedom, it's not true anymore. Like, even though you make the most awesome game, you will probably have a tough time making money out of it, unless you find out a strategy of going to market. So I think as a game developer, I think, again, we're certainly back to the to-market side of everything. So definitely there's been a huge change. And with mobile, again, last year we've seen, again, people could strike out with making a small mobile game and then hopefully get featured. And that would do a lot for you. I have a friend, I can't say who he is or what he does, but he had a mobile game featured in 110 countries. He just made a small game, right? The game was really awesome. He hardly sold 10,000 units of that game. It's a premium game, it's not free to play. So that, I mean, it showed that it's even more difficult than what I thought. Not to say that it's impossible. We have a lot of good examples in Sweden. Mediocre, for example, is a really good example. They made two games, both awesome, both are really successful. Does it answer your questions on the business side?
Well, that's fine. It's a perspective. Anyone else want to weigh in on the perspective, on the business perspective? Gemma?
Yeah, sort of on a broad business perspective, I think coming off the back of that, one thing that is clear is that games have diversified in terms of how they are played as much as how they are being made. And of course, the two go hand in hand. So actually, calling back in your question about YouTubers as well, games can now be seen as an entertainment product, something other than something interactive. So in the same way that games are now being designed to be YouTube friendly. Mike Bithell is a good example of this. I don't think Thomas Was Alone was particularly developed with YouTubing in mind, but he took a lot of good business decisions alongside that in order to make it YouTube friendly. It came out at the time when there was a lot of umming and ahhing about copyright takedown notices, for example, and he made efforts to ensure that his YouTuber fans were protected so that they could show his game and therefore spread the message about it. And this is something we see in local multiplayer as well. In the same way that if you're designing a local multiplayer game, your best bet is to make something which is entertaining to watch so that the other people waiting to play will still be gripped and will eventually get around to playing it. I think that sort of diversification is affecting how we're making the games as well. And it's expressed in the types of platforms people are playing on as well. Definitely.
Great, thanks. Actually, this is what we'll do. Now we heard their opinions, now we want your opinions. So start thinking about questions or comments for the panel, and we'll come to you in a second. Because, yeah, Stefan, but I really want to hear Patrick's point about the YouTubers. Okay, Stefan first, and then you. The pressure is on you, Patrick, to make something cool now with the YouTubers.
I'm really stupid because there's also been a huge change in how we purchase games, right? So I forgot about that one because you tricked me into talking about developing side. Sorry.
Yeah, it's on
me. Was my bad. So how do we actually buy games? Nobody goes into a store. Not nobody. Okay, I'm painting white and black, but nobody buys games in the retail market anymore. people do, but it's not to the extent that we used to be. So obviously that has changed a lot. And then following up on YouTube, we also have what we call game as a service. That's the industry term. What does that mean? It means that we have games that change. Maybe you don't even have to pay for them. And some of the more popular ones are now turning into sport, which is awesome. I really didn't want to talk about this because I have too many hours in League of Legends, so I'm not trying to think about that because then my brain turns to that. But I mean that has changed completely the way that we interact or buy games or so and making purchases in games, which is important for business, right? Because Riot, if they didn't make a cent, they wouldn't be able to continue to support that huge technical infrastructure or provide new content to game. That we as gamers want, and the game would stagnate, right? So, and then the esports side is obviously really interesting in the way how that will move forward. I read some article just recently about ESPN, and there are discussions of bringing it even more to the mainstream, out of like specific cabling, and which is super interesting. I don't really watch them because I like to play them, but a lot of people do. So that's an interesting fact.
Thanks. Okay, Patrick, your point about the YouTubers.
Are we there now? It's going to be, you're talking about a nightmare.
Oh, you want to save that for the nightmare scenario?
It is two things.
All right. So
related to the nightmare. So
you can save that then to the
nightmare. I'll save
it. Okay. So that's the cliffhanger. That's the industry.
Cliffhanger.
Yeah. Da-da. Terminology. You never heard about that. Before we take some questions from the floor, Richard, you went from making games as a business into academia, yeah. And now you're turning academia into a business because you have the USC label.
Publishing.
How has the business changed in the past 15 years?
I mean, lots of the great points have already been mentioned. The transition from boxed products on shelves that meant you had to work with a particular kind of business who could put the games on trucks and send them out to the stores, to now you need to work with someone who has server farms to deliver this content digitally. I think about the way that we have changed in the way that we make games. In 2001, we were writing big game design documents like this. I've written too many of those that then got thrown away on the first day of development because we discovered something. And in 2002, I think it was, Mark Cerny gave a very important talk at DICE in Las Vegas, proposing the method that Insomniac and Naughty Dog use, which is kind of agile in character. So obviously the ascendancy of agile in terms of the business of the way that we run studios, staying on our toes, thinking in a, which, you know, also I think applies to our overall business models as we discover new ways to monetize our games, sometimes pivoting partway through. So there are countless ways in which the business of making and distributing games has changed.
The agile, was that because of lack of insight or because we didn't have the technology to support that methodology?
Well, I think your mention of the technology, of course, the tools have changed wildly. The fact that in 2001 we were struggling to build a game engine to implement the kinds of features that we wanted. To build the engine, my friend Brian Allgaier, who's an amazing creative director at Insomniac, you'll know him from the Ratchet and Clank games and Insomniac's new VR game, he says that back then game development was like trying to do a transatlantic crossing and beginning floating in the ocean surrounded by the disassembled parts of a boat. And we try and start swimming towards America, building the boat as we go. Now, you know, with the amazing game engines that we have available to us, things are radically different. And that does mean that we can make games in a fundamentally different way. We can start with a loose but firm plan and set out in a direction. And as we implement things and make them good and polish them, we can kind of, in a way, allow the game's design to lead production where the game and the audience of players for the game want it to go. And I think that is a radical shift that is useful. It's going to be useful in every aspect of our lives, from urban planning to managing healthcare, all these different civic challenges that we'll face in the 21st century around ecology and climate management. This kind of thinking could be useful.
Yeah, games have a lot to deliver to the rest of the world. Now, did we have some questions? Yes, over here, please. Anyone else? Yes. Okay. So what I'll do is I'll take a few questions, and then we'll ask the panel to comment. Sir.
Yes. Hello. I was wondering during the speech if you think gamers have become lazier, as to the decrease of couch co-op, and I don't have to go out and buy my game. I can just download it on Steam or appropriate apps. That gamers are becoming lazier due to the increase of YouTubers and Twitch streamers and the like.
Was that gamers have become lazy?
Gamers.
Lazy gamers. And we'll take the next question right away, actually, while you ponder the answer to the lazy gamers. And that's over here, yes. And I'll do this cool dance, and you can all try these moves later. They're very hard, but I practiced many years. Yes.
I wanted to talk about the, you know, I love Just Cause 3, but I was bummed out when I tried to play it on the boat back home to Stockholm, because I needed internet to play the game. And, you know, it's a single-player game, but were some leaderboards things. But, you know, it's becoming more of this, like, you need to be online to play games, even though they're single-player. And, you know, also in the past, with the GameCube also, that wasn't a thing, because the internet wasn't that big of a thing at that time. I just wanted to like bring up that issue and see what your thoughts were on the issue.
Thanks. And one last one? Yes. If you just pass the mic down here, please. All right. Yes, sir.
Yes. Right. Okay. Well, I'm a third year student, and my thesis paper or project paper, I'm not sure, is about, mine and my partner is about the online disinhibition effect and how it differs in the game industry, like what type of differences we have and what type of obstacles we have to climb onto. And what we found out was we are really, really good at maximizing dissociative imagination, creating really good worlds and affecting our players really badly. So we're developing more, multiple personality disorders. And so we're creating those types of effects a lot now. But we're really good at decreasing what we call what the online disinhibition model calls minimizing authority, and that's something I would really like to know. Like, what are you guys' thoughts of in the industry? What do you think the future will be to how to minimize, how to maximize authority, just to create a just to create an environment where you would behave a bit more like real life. What are you guys' plans about that?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, come on. I was way too easy on them. So we have the lazy gamers, we have online single player, and we have maximized authority. That's a pretty cool title for a game in the first place. Stefan, yeah. Why did you make Just Cause Online also in the single player?
I'll start with that because that's the easy one. So I remember when Half-Life came out, they required me to hook up to something called Steam. Maybe really fucking angry. I mean, what the fuck is Steam at that time? But eventually I did it because I couldn't play without hooking up to Steam. And look at where Steam are at today. So, but I just wanted to say that because I can share that frustration. I hear you. So with the game that Avalanche made, you know, there's a tight, very close relationship with the publisher. The publisher has a lot of weight into these different decisions. Also, there's an ambition for the developer to make the game better in every aspect than the last one, right? So obviously, Just Cause 2 didn't have any online component. Both the studio and the publisher were looking for some way to integrate that. That said, making a game like Just Cause 3 is not trivial. So adding things upon like the foundation, what Just Cause is, with the huge open world and three-dimensional gameplay, vertical gameplay. We had to come up with something to meet the publisher's demands of having that online connection, and eventually it ended up with being the more simplistic, it's not simple, but leaderboards, etc., that you're talking about, and real-time change in those, which is the actual feature. So you will be able to do stunts, take the high score, remember what I said about scores, log in again and see that, oh, okay, Patrick now has the high score. That would not be true, but like he beat my high score. But you see my point. So, and eventually I think that ended up with being online only requirement because of technical aspects and also because of the maybe more content is in the future is going to tie into that. Who knows?
So I would actually direct that criticism to Destination Gotland more than Avalanche. Okay, who wants to do the Lazy Gamers? Lazy Gamers? Yeah, Richard.
Yeah, it's an interesting subject. I don't think I would use the word lazy. I think it's a mistake to characterize enormous groups of people with simple terms. I do think it's interesting the way that, you know, people's habits, the way they lead their lives evolve over time and the amount of time that we spend doing this or that. I grew up in the countryside in the west of England, and Shigeru Miyamoto is famous for also having grown up in the countryside and the fact that his childhood adventures kind of led him to create the kinds of games that he made, exploring underground caverns and, you know, and the forest and so on. And recent research shows us that over the course of the time when I was a child in the 70s to the present day, the mean free roam range of a child has decreased from something like, I think, 2 kilometers to something like 200 meters, especially in urban spaces. So kids just don't go far away from home. And I don't think that video games are the cause of that. I think that there are probably many, many causes in society for something like that. Video games probably have a relationship with that, you know, because they provide these rich experiences of adventure right here in the home where my parents know that I'm safe. And I wonder how games in the future can help find a better balance around this, because I think it's important that we as individuals get out into the world and explore. That's how we come to understand the incredible diversity of human life on this planet, and hopefully eventually will lead us to live in more harmony with one another as international citizens. I think games like Ingress are interesting. I don't know any Ingress players here. Great. It's a pervasive game where you play on a couple of different teams and you have to seize bases which are physical locations in the real world. In your city, and it's a game made by Niantic Labs. Check it out. It's a game that has led me to discover new interesting places in Los Angeles because I'm seeking out a base that's nearby so I can capture it to see some points for my team. But usually the bases are things like pieces of public art or other interesting locations, and I think games will be able to help to ensure that we don't become lazy as players.
And without the kids exploring, we would have never found Lummelunda grottorna. Now we're running out of time, so you have to work in the maximum authority to your ending comments, your closing remarks. That's the word I'm looking for. Actually, I'd like to start with you, Stefan. And you have 1 minute each to give me first where do you think we're going to be in 15 years, because now we're looking forward, we're done with the past, and where you wish we would be in 15 years. So realistic and dream scenario, 1 minute.
1 minute, okay. Hopefully those two will align then, so the realism becomes
true. Save you some time.
So for me, I think, like, remember what I said about isolation? So I grew up playing role-playing games, right? So we had social interaction. There were human contact, which I think is really important. VR, even more isolation. I'm hidden behind this mask, and I'm playing in my living room. Okay, I might be playing multiplayer games, play against others. So if we're gonna do this in 1 minute, I would argue that augmented reality is really interesting because there are companies out there, if you haven't checked them out or heard about them called Meta or Magical Leap is even more interesting, because they're trying to create things in the world that we can interact with or change our world. So one example would be, I can be actually a part of a Harry Potter movie. I can interact with Harry, I can cast spells, I can have my friends join in as either new characters in Hogwarts or play as some of the existing characters, and we can do that together. We can interact, feel human warmth, but we can also act out our fantasies, because eventually, I mean, in reality, games is an escape from your sad reality, if you have a sad reality, or doing the dishes or whatever. I asked a friend, just going to conclude with that, maybe 1 year ago, I asked him, why are we making, oh, 2 years ago, when I left Avalanche. One of the reasons was that I felt like we're not curing cancer. I'm not curing cancer. What is it? Why is it important for me? What am I doing to change the world, to help others? And he told me a very interesting thing. He told me, yeah, I think, like, if you're a mine worker in Brazil, that's his example. So you work in a coal mine, maybe you work 12 times a day. You come back to your home, you play World of Warcraft, and you're maxed out guild leader, super strong. That's his way of escaping reality and becoming someone else and living his dream. And if that makes him happy and you're part of that, that's actually making a change. I'm adding to someone else's life, making them more happy. But in the future, I think AR is an interesting thing, I think, to conclude with that, because it takes in, I'm not occluded, I'm not isolated, and it's part of the real world. So I just tie that back to what I'm saying. I'm afraid that gaming is making us more isolated in terms of where we are playing it and how we're playing it, maybe.
Stefan Ljungqvist, thanks for warning for the isolation and also for bringing Score back into the conversation. Yes. Okay, Patrick, now we really want to know your cliffhanger with the YouTubers.
Yeah,
and your nightmare scenario.
Yeah, I got the pitch, the nightmare scenario. Thanks.
Sure.
So, and I combined that with a YouTuber, and it's two problems that I'm seeing right now that can be a nightmare for specifically me, but probably a lot of you too here in the future. And one with YouTuber is I'm starting to see the younger generation of players, they are not playing anymore. They're spending more time on looking at people playing. And if this is going to be a trend, will we hire a player for us in the future? It's actually, I'm seeing it on my 8 years on, and it's too much time spending on YouTube, and I'm actually forcing him to go play and be interactive with something. That feels strange from my upbringing, when I said, like, go out and play in the wilds, extend your web of, your range, yeah. So that's a little bit, I'm actually a little bit scared of that, because there's no interactivity at all there, and just by looking at other people, if this is going to be something that's going to be bigger in the future, then I don't want to be part of that. And the next is as a developer, I told you yesterday that we try to work with the best. We want to be a developer, we introverts. You have to be that good, sacrifice something at the crossroad with Satan. and we don't want to do marketing and stuff like that. And when you work with a publisher right now, traditional, they don't understand and don't have the structure to working with YouTubers, for example. It's such a big channel. So then we have to handle that. And are we developers or are we marketers or are we both? It feels now that you, as an independent developer, have to start not just only be good developer, you have to be even better at marketing and see all the new trends and follow these. So that's my two nightmares in one direction, YouTubers.
Great, thank you. So those were actually two nightmares and no dream scenario. So I guess the dream is to avoid those. No, I appreciate that. Thank you. Okay, Gemma Thompson, 1 minute. What do you think we'll be in 15 years, and where do you want us to be in 15 years? Don't say bring back the GameCube.
Well, I am going to jump off the authority and worlds question, actually. My friend Catherine Cross has written and spoken quite extensively on the subject of online harassment and the way that the people who dish it out tend to feel empowered by the lack of repercussions from their actions. And I think this is something that games could potentially fix. Yeah, it's that these are worlds in which players are projecting themselves more into, and we have within us the power to make them think about their actions, either directly or through analogs. That's a unique element of game design, I think. And so I'm not sure if it's a dream or a reality, because I think discussion around this is so prevalent now that I actually have hopes that we probably could do something like that. I think maybe as a broader dream, I would extend that out to games as a whole and as a medium having less stigma attached to it. We're already managing to drift apart from the idea of a gamer as a nerd with associated baggage, usually insulting ideas about all manners of their personality. And that's definitely changing because, as we know, I mean, so many more people are playing games and they don't identify as gamers. It's becoming a rather pervasive medium. And so I think that the more we distract from that, the more we can stop thinking about putting so much effort into what is a gamer and actually just getting on and playing them and enjoying them, I think is my main thing.
Yes. Good. Yes. Richard has a special little move that sort of inspires the applause. Okay, Richard, what's your...
It's my finger clicking. I learned it at poetry slams. Oh, when you like something, you don't want to interrupt the flow of the conversation.
Oh,
give
really?
Give some finger snaps.
I thought that was from golf.
Maybe golfers, yeah. I think, do it too.
I don't know if poetry came first or golf. Anyway, what's your...
Golf. Games always first.
True.
I guess my take on the probable future is that just as 15 years ago, there was really kind of one industry. Nowadays, when we offhandedly refer to the game industry, I think we're actually talking about an overlapping set of about 12 different industries, all with different business models, methods of distribution, audiences. And so my prediction for 15 years in the future is that there may be 12 times 12 industries, hundreds of games industries, and associated industries in play design, experiential design, interactive design, with many, many different kinds of products and services available to people to play. I think that it's a bit like, if you can imagine it, it's going to exist. Just like as game designers, we create spaces of possibility that is hard for us. It means we have to spend a lot of time QAing them because there are so many points of possibility out there that our players will discover on the first day. I think we'll see all kinds of weird, wonderful, exciting, joyful, troubling stuff. Biological games, games for robots, for robotic people, games for where NPCs are controlled by groups of hundreds of players that you can have a conversation with, like I can have a conversation with you now. All kinds of weird, wonderful stuff. I guess my hope, my dream for 15 years from now is that while sometimes the world looks like a really scary, troubled place, and certainly many, many people who live on this planet face terrible challenges in their lives because they live in a place that's in civil war or they don't have access to clean drinking water, my friend, who has a good optimistic character that I like, says that when you look at the actual facts, we're getting actually a little better each year. Each year we provide a bit more education to the world's population. We provide a bit more shelter and food and clean water to the world's population. And like I was saying this morning, I believe that culture has a big role to play. Culture is a kind of conversation that we have with ourselves to discuss what the world is like and what we want it to be like, what we are like and what we want to be like. And I think games have a role to play in that in the future, to solve some of these problems, to we won't ever get it perfect, but at least to allow more people to live more happy, fulfilled, safe lives so that we can advance in education, science, technology, the arts, and work together to build spaceships, to explore the galaxy together forever. And that's my dream.
Well, I know one thing for sure, and that is that in 15 years we'll meet back here again at the Gotland Game Conference, and you know, 14 times in between. So this has been the Per Strömbäck panel. I had my own little agenda item in the program. That's a first. Very happy for that. Very humbling. I'd like to thank you, dear audience, for your questions and comments and criticism. I'd like to thank the panel for your infinite wisdom and vision and experience. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to do this thing that I love so much. And I'd like to thank all you students for all the great games you've made on display there. And I'm looking forward to everything that comes after with the party and the gala and all that stuff. But I think that's it, unless Håkan wants to say.
I would like to thank you, Per, for this great panel. This was a terrific experience. Thanks. Yeah, guys?
You did all the hard work. Thank you so much. Thank you. All right, and that's it. Tack så mycket. Tack, Patrick.